Good morning to everybody. Now we are having the second part of the lecture number one for remote sensing, and this lecture is related to the introduction of the course. In the first part, you remember we approach all the what is related to the organization of the course, the timetable, the materials, the logistics, and especially the final examinations. Now we are starting in this second part with what you can find in the remote sensing basics, and most of that are, of course, taken for the PDF file, and this is really related to the introduction of to the topics of the course. So, starting with this introduction, is important to mention that for human beings, they need to know their territory and the environments where they live. It has always been of vital importance. And this is from the origins when the information was restricted to a very simple ones, for example, a set of indication on paths or routes in order to get food, up to nowadays, in which the information gathered through satellites consists mainly of physical measurements and scientific observation. So, in these optics, the platforms able to convey information are in fact essential for future challenges. The actual possibility of observing the surface of the Earth from above could only be achieved with the developments in aerospace technology. At the same time, the results obtained in the field of photography, optics, and electronics have made it possible to extend acquisition capability beyond the visible, offering to human mankind new tools for observing his environments. These are all these data are conveyed by electromagnetic radiation, which according to their frequency have been classified as cosmic rays, gamma, X-rays, ultraviolet, visible, infrared, microwave, and radio, up to direct current for infinite wavelength values. So in these slides, what is important to get is that thanks to the developments, especially in aerospace technology, and this is very important because you will see that the sensors that are used for remote sensing are mounted on board of satellites or aerial platforms. And thanks to the innovation related to the optics, electronics, and photography, remote sensing is able to extend, like you can see in bold here, to extend the acquisition capability beyond the visible. So I mean, this is the first very important concept of the course, that these sensors are able to overcome the limitation of the human vision. And all these data that you will see is possible to acquire from these sensors are conveyed in terms of electromagnetic radiation. And so you have here a list of names, of conventional names, you see, that are ranging from cosmic rays to radio bands that will characterize, as we will see in the second lecture, the electromagnetic spectra. All right. This type of investigation, called remote sensing, studies reality from particular spectral and radiometric point of view, combining observations related to the dynamics of the observed phenomena and their physical content with those relative to their position in space privileged by other disciplines of the surveys. So what does it mean? That means that the terms remote sensing, and we will explore the meaning of these terms in few slides, is related to the possibility to investigate how a surface that usually is placed over the Earth's surface is, behaving in terms of emission and reflectance of electromagnetic energy. That means that from a strictly historical point of view, we can place the beginning of the remote sensing techniques with the birth and development of the photographic techniques that took place, as you can see here, in 1838, which, together with the properties of various focal lens optics, allowed the humans to extend their possibility of vision, as well to record the observations for the first time in the history of humanity in an objective and permanent way. So, in this second paragraph, apart from the exact date in which we can place the birth of remote sensing, that is around the middle of the 19th century, there's again this concept of the extension of the possibilities from the spectral point of view of the human vision, but there's also another very important concept, that is the possibility to record the observations. That means that, for the first time in 1838, you will have a film, something that was used to image a particular target, and that means that apart from the memory that is very important also for the remote sensing, the memory that we have in our brain, what is very important is to record on physical media the data we can acquire from these sensors. The possibility to observe above the Earth's surface in order to have a broader and more synthetic vision of the phenomena, has always been considered a must. For example, like the shepherds, who in order to count their sheep, look from a hill near their flock. So that means that, the possibility to observe from above is very important for humans. Because, you can use this kind of view in order to have a synoptic view of your area. Synoptic means that you have a view that could enlarge your vision, and apart from, for example, the position of your own house, you can see in a broader vision which is the condition of the neighborhood, for example. And this is very important in order to associate data to extract different information, for example. And these things raise, especially with the invention of the telescope and the discovery of photography, as I already mentioned, and the human observer acquired, in addition to the possibility of improving his capability of observation of the real world, as I mentioned before, and this is written in bold, the ability to record permanently and quantitatively the information of visual time. So, here we have another concept that is added, apart from the possibility to record the data, that these data are numbers. So, numbers could be compared to each other in order to characterize, for example, different behavior in these acquired data. So this is important because for the first time information that you can derive from just visual information are recorded stably in on a media. Well, remote sensing, for all intents and purposes, was born with technological developments following the World War II and took his decisive starts in the 60s of the last century. In many different fields, such as optics, electronics, and information technology. Then, with the development of new sensors, transmission, and sciences related to data processing, the capacity to extend the visual perception beyond natural limits was eventually granted, extending the possible detection and recording in wider regions of the electromagnetic spectrum. So, I mean, from these paragraphs, we can fully understand that around the 60s, we will have the first technological platforms related to the recent innovation at the time concerning, for example, electronics, transmission, computer science, and so on, and of course, sensors, that for the first time, granting the possibility to extend the possibility of the human vision to other parts of the electromagnetic spectrum. In fact, the first image of the Earth that was transmitted by the Tyros 1 meteorological satellites in 1960 produce an extraordinary effects, not only on the scientific community, but also on the public opinion. And trust me, in 1960, when all the people could see on the newspaper or on the TV, the first image of the Earth's surface taken from satellites, that was really unbelievable. And also public, also common people understood at the time that, I mean, that was the beginning of a new era in which all the characteristics of the Earth could be acquired from above, from satellites. So granting a sort of understanding of what is happening on the Earth's surface, but also giving to who is using satellite a strategic dominance, because there's also this military and strategic concept related to the advent of artificial satellites. And this first image and these first acquisitions convinced also the scientists of the great possibilities awarded by spatial platforms. Okay, now before starting with the definition of remote sensing, we need to introduce a general concept. The general concept is related to what we intended as geomatics. Because I mean, I'm introducing here also different disciplines of the geomatics that are part of this course, at least in a narrative way, because we will mention to these disciplines in order to solve some problems. And I will do that in the introductory part, because then we will talk essentially of remote sensing. So the concept of geomatics, as the word say, is related to the usage of informatics, of computer science, to the study of the geo. So I mean the Earth. So I mean in geomatics we have all these disciplines which are studying the Earth using computer science devices, both hardware and software. And in particular, these disciplines, as you see here, are ranging from geodesy, topography, photogrammetry, of course, remote sensing, and cartography. Starting from geodesy, geodesy is a discipline that is aiming to study the shape of the Earth. That is called, as you know, in a technical term, geoids, because you know that Shape of the Earth is not a sphere, is not an ellipsoid. I mean, we can assimilate to an ellipsoid, but I mean, it's something different. So in order to study the shape of the Earth, geodesy is taken into consideration, as we can see in the next slides. The possible to refine the power of mathematical analysis with the precision of measurements. In order to study this geoid, that you know is a sort of very big potatoes, and you know to describe in a very accurate way the shape of these potatoes, because it's very important for all the other disciplines. And while the Earth is not be considered no longer, apart from some idealization, is not considered right now as a rigid body in uniform rotation. But on the contrary, it's necessary to take into account the relative movements of the clothes in which the Earth's crust is divided, the terrestrial tides comes from the attraction of the moon and the sun, and many other phenomena. So you should think about the Earth like a very complex system that is representing not a rigid body in uniform rotation, but something that is very elastic. And you will see also from remote sensing images that we can have at least the feeling of this elastic behavior of the Earth. In addition, in geodesy, is took advantage from the global positioning system, the GPS, the well-known GPS, that is should be considered one of the first massive constellation of satellites ever launched by human mankind, that is able to give you a very accurate position on the ground. And so having so many and massive measurements on the ground, of course, it's possible to define in a very accurate way the shape of this geoid, what we assimilate to a very big potato. All right, the second discipline that we are referring to is, of course, the topography. The topography is deals with the methods and tools that allow the determination and the metric representation of points and elements of the physical surface on the Earth. So, I mean, we are using different tools, different instruments, in order to simply measure the position of points over the ground surface, sometimes in the space, sometimes underground, but usually over the Earth's surface. So I mean, it's a very simple concept. We are measuring concept, we are measuring position of single points, and maybe we can also connect single points to form polylines, or we can close polylines and consider areas. So that means that with the topography, we can measure the position of points, the length of lines, and areas, for example. And I mean, which is the output of topography? That the output of topography is generally a metric map on an appropriate scale. So I mean, the stating that topography is measuring the position of pointing of points, lines, or area on the ground, or polygons on the ground, you can build what is called reference maps. So I mean the position of every single natural or anthropogenic features that we have on the ground, for example, roads, buildings, but also rivers and whatever you want. So the aims of topography, of course, is not only to produce reference maps, but also to control with these movements in a multi-temporal with multi-temporal goals, so measuring in different time span to, for example, control the stability of structures, the design of reliefs for large civil engineering works, the measurements of areas, of course, the survey of urban centers, archaeological sites, monuments, etc., etc. What is very important for remote sensing is the discipline that is attained to photogrammetry. Photogrammetry, a special aerial photogrammetry, is a modern survey method of the territory that follows the production of metric maps. As you may be know, it's based on a very simple concept. So the possibility to acquire images from different point of view of the same target. So you are imaging the same target from different taken position and establishing the position, the metrical position of this taken position. I mean, you can reconstruct the geometry of the takens and then to build a 3D model. So having imaged this target from the different points of view, you can extract 3D coordinates of the points, and so you can survey in a fully three-dimensional with a fully three-dimensional techniques the target you are imaging. And this is very important because you can imagine that, from satellites, of course you can acquire images, and if you are acquiring images of the same area from two different points of view, of course also from satellites, you can use these photogrammetric techniques in order to describe in a full 3D your territory. The last disciplines of the geomatics is what is intended as cartography from the technical point of view, what is intended as mapping, and the basic problem of mapping or cartography is the representation of a curved surface on a plane. So, starting with the facts that we are taking into consideration the geoid, that is the Earth's surface, I mean, we need to represent that in a b-dimensional plane, that is the b-dimensional plane of our paper map, or our b-dimensional plane of our PC screen. So, I mean, we need to use mathematics in order to have this projective and descriptive geometry in order to represent this curved surface on a plane. Of course, this operation is not, has some error as input, but it's not a perfect operation. So, you have redundancy and errors coming from these projector operations. But what we need to know is that these errors, we know that these are some errors and some incongruences, but we are able to measure that. What is important for us in the remote sensing course is that mapping and cartography pursues two technical objectives. The first one is the production of metric maps that is the final results also for topography, so to produce reference maps, but also to represent thematic maps, and this is the second purpose. Thematic maps is the possibility to represent your area, your territory, by surfaces or themes that are having uniform characteristics, such as urbanized vegetation, geology, hydrology, and so on. It does not have a strict metric characteristics, even though the representation basis is usually metric, but it must provide a realistic thematic accuracy. So that means that with the mapping, with cartography, apart from the reference maps, we are also used to produce thematic maps. And you will see that in remote sensing, you can do both, but especially the second. I mean, with the remote sensing imageries, you can produce reference maps, but you can also use this data to produce thematic maps, so to produce classes of a particular phenomenons. At the end of this slide, you will see that for this last reason, so the possibility to have a realistic thematic accuracy, the thematic cartography must have a regular updating. So I mean, should be updated as also the reference maps, but especially the thematic map one. Consider, for example, classes related to vegetation. Of course, the vegetation is changing over the different seasons. So I mean, you need to update this data. And the best way to update these maps is by using data acquired from satellites. And you will see how that is possible. All right, so now let's pass to the remote sensing definitions. And let's start with the general definition of remote sensing. Remote sensing is here, you can see here in bold, is the scientific disciplines that allows to acquire qualitative and quantitative data on remote objects placed and on the surrounding environment on the basis of measurements of electromagnetic energy emitted, reflected, or transmitted, which interacts with the areas of interest. So let's go through this general definition. The first one is that remote sensing is a scientific discipline. What does it mean, scientific disciplines? That being a scientific discipline, there's a scientific theory behind that, and this is the aim of this course, but also that there are some technologies that are in some way exploring these theoretical aspects. And then the second concept is that remote sensing is giving you the possibility to acquire qualitative and quantitative data. So that means that you see, by means of sensors, we are able to acquire quantitative and also qualitative data in some way. And the third concept that is embedded in remote sensing term is that we are acquiring data from a remote position. So the terms remote here in sensing means that the sensor that is acquiring the data is far from the target to be imaged, to be acquired. So I mean, remote, the term remote in remote sensing means that the sensor has no physical contact with the target to be investigated. All right? And we will talk about this concept of remote in terms of how far is the sensor in correspondence to the target. And the fourth element of the definition is that all these data are based on the measurements of electromagnetic energy, all right? And this electromagnetic energy, this is a corollary information, can be emitted, reflected, or transmitted with the target that we are acquiring, that we are investigating. So, recapping four different concepts in this definition, remote sensing is a scientific discipline. It's embedding the possibility to acquire data. These data are acquired from, and this is the third definition, from a remote position, and all these data are conveyed in terms of electromagnetic energy. This definition, therefore, includes all the set of techniques, tools, and interpretation tools that allow to improve the perceptive abilities of the human eye and brain, provide the observer with information on object placed at a distance and on the surrounding environments. So here, again, remote sensing, one of the main advantages of remote sensing is that he's improving the perceptive abilities of the human eye, and we will see how he's improving that, but also the perceptive abilities of the brain. That means that you will see, especially at the end of the course, that we can use some algorithms that are able to simulate our brain processes to extract information from this data. So, I mean, this is the most important advantage of remote sensing, to extend the capabilities of our eyes and brain. In general, it can be said that remote sensing allows to perform quantitative remote measurements of physical characteristics linked to surfaces and with certain boundary conditions, also related to subsurface situation. So, in very general terms, remote sensing allows the possibility to acquire remote measurements of physical characteristics. Okay. Data and the possible information we can extract from data, whether qualitative or quantitative, then comes directly from surfaces, generally located, as I mentioned before, far from the observer. This distance from the sensor and the target to be investigated can vary in a very different way. For example, we can acquire images from very few meters, and in this case we are mentioning the techniques as proximal sensing, you see here, up to thousands of kilometers, and in this case we are referring especially to remote sensing techniques, with, for example, the extreme case of distance in data that are acquired from satellites that are, as you can see here, 36,000 kilometers away from the Earth's surface. So, for example, just to be very pragmatic, and not to talk about something that is not new, for example, the human vision is a typical example of remote sensing tool, because, I mean, we can image the scene that we are observing without any physical contacts with the target itself. And we can, of course, observe from very far. For example, if we are up to the mountains and we are observing the landscape, but we can also observe from very close distance. And that means that, of course, the distances make the observation very different from each other. But consider that, for example, human eyes is a typical remote sensing system, and as a remote sensing systems, we will approach also the human vision in the theoretical part, and we will have a lesson in particular where I will describe the human vision, because we need to fully understand how the human vision is working in order to understand the advantage, but eventually the limitation of the human vision, because it's very important for us being observing with our eyes, for example, the images that are acquired by satellites. But you have also to consider that in this case also the camera, the digital camera that we have on board of our cellular phone, it's definitely a remote sensing sensor, because again, there's no physical contact with the surface or with the scene that you are pictures. And when you are imaging using a digital camera, you are at the end using electromagnetic energy as a convey, as a media to convey the data to the camera itself of the scene acquired. Okay, here in and you see here in remote sensing, the measurable quantity is definitely the electronic, the electromagnetic energy that is coming from investigative services, like I was mentioning just a few minutes ago, talking about eyes or digital cameras. On digital camera in our eyes, we are simply collecting energy, electromagnetic energy that is reflected from the scene that we are observing with our eyes or with our digital cameras. All right. So remote sensing extends man's observation abilities into space, so from above, overcoming the spectral limitation of our retina, enabling the exploration of the invisible fields in the electromagnetic spectrum. Because I mean, this is a concept of invisible, because what is not, I mean, our eye are really limited in the spectrum, as you will see in the second lecture, in the electromagnetic spectra. So what is not the part of the electromagnetic spectrum where our eyes are not sensitive, of course, are invisible for us. And so the possibility to use sensors that are sensitive to this part of the spectrum grant to humans a very big advantage. So to see above and over the invisible. So here is also very important another concept, that is this one, that remote sensing is granting also the multi-temporal perspective. What is the multi-temporal perspective? In the sense that you can, as you can really see, you can read here, that the data are taken from satellite continuously since 1972, and they are stored in archives from that date. So I mean, more or less 50 years. So the multi-temporal perspective means that, we have access to data that are acquired over time. So I mean, the multi-temporal perspective means that we can analyze and approach dynamic processes, because we can use data acquired in different time spans. And in this different dynamic process could range, for example, from the enlargement or from the spreading of the urban areas, for example. And so, for example, if you are using an image acquired in the 70s, and one image acquired a few days ago, we can check, for example, how urban areas has enlarged during the last 50 years. But we can also check which is the evolution of the flooding or a forest fires, because I mean, in this case, we need a multi-temporal approach. For example, and here for very small time spans, for example, if we are taking into consideration a forest fire, we need a data, an image that is acquired previously, and then an image acquired after the forest fire, in order to check the consequences of that. So I mean, you see that multi-temporal analyses are very important, and remote sensing is granting this possibility Think, for example, of the phenological state of the vegetation. I mean, remote sensing is very much used for vegetation, and in order to check the state of the growing of the vegetation, you need multi-temporal images in order to establish these things. So, I mean, this is something that is very important for remote sensing. All right. Normally, the study and the analysis of a phenomenon or a surface carried out with remote sensing techniques involve three distinct phases, and we see here the three distinct phases. The first one is the data acquisition that usually is made by sensor mounted on board of aerial or satellite platforms. Then we have the second phase, that is the data processing, that is the possibility using softwares and hardware to process data in order to correct, for example, the data, and finally and eventually in the third point, to the interpretation and the usage of data. So, what is very important in these three points is what is the general paradigm that we are using in remote sensing, but not only in remote sensing. But for remote sensing is very, very important and is crucial. I mean, what do we should know since the beginning is that we are using data and we have really a massive amount of data acquired from satellite, because just to have an example, you have to consider that now at the European level, the larger big data archive that is available on European, in the European framework, is the archive of satellite images of the European Space Agency. So that means that we are acquiring a massive amount of data, but the general paradigm for us that is guiding us in all these calls and in all the labs that we will have is that we need to process this data in order to extract valuable information from this data. So the paradigm for us is that out from this data, we need to extract information, and this information should be valuable. So should lead to a usage, to have some advantage, because otherwise, if you are only acquiring data and this data could not be converted in valuable information, it makes no sense to acquire this data. And I remind you, the data are simply numbers. So I mean, out from numbers, we cannot get anything. If we are interpreting this number, we can get out from them information. So, as regards the detection instruments using these disciplines can be divided in two different categories, and this is very important also. There are the instruments that are providing single measurements, and these instruments, for example, are the radiometers, spectrometers, scatterometers, or others. All those instruments that provide images that are simply ordered set of single measurements. And these sensors are called spectrum converter tubes, fast and slow scanning devices, digital cameras, thermal imaging cameras, and so on, so on, and so on. In the framework of this course, of course, we will take into consideration almost instruments, the sensor that are providing in a direct way images and not single measurement. All right, All acquiring tools, you can see here, are called sensu, with a meaning that includes several functions. So, radiation collection, transduction, control, recording, reproduction, transmission. But in our calls, in a more restrictive sense, on the other hand, we are using the term sensors, only indicating the radiation collector device, that is also called detector. So I mean, for our aims in remote sensing, we are very interested in checking, and we will do that in the next lectures, how a detector is working and how a detector is embedded in a more complex sensor. And we are considering detector as a radiation collector device, electromagnetic radiation that coming from the observed scene, from the imaged scene. Another very important distinction can be made by the different sensors, because we can have two different families of sensors. The first one are called passive sensors, and the other one are called active sensors. Passive sensors are acquiring data in a passive way. That means they need an external source of electromagnetic radiation, while the active sensors are able to produce by their own a source of electromagnetic radiation and then to record back the reflection that is coming from the target that is imaged. In order to give you a very simple example of these two kind of sensor, passive and active, I can just introduce the fact that, on our cellular phones we have a digital camera, and if we are taking a picture with a digital camera, outside or in an inner space, we can take picture if there's illumination enough in order to impress the sensor of our digital camera that we have on board of our cellular phones. So I mean, for example, if we are in a very sunny day and we are outside, we can of course acquire an image with our camera, and of course this is considered as a passive system, because we can use and we can image the scene that we are observing because it's illuminated by an external source of energy, for example outside the sun. If we are in an inner room, for example, we can take a picture if there's an artificial illumination. But if we are in dark condition, both because we are in the middle of the night or because there's no electric light switch on in our room, of course it's not possible to acquire an image with our digital camera. Or you can acquire an image, but the energy that is reflected from the scene is not enough in order to impress the sensor. So we are acquiring that in a passive way. But in that lack of illumination, of electromagnetic radiation, what we can do? We can just enable the flash. If we are using flash with our digital camera, we are using a sort of active system. I mean, we are emitting energy by using the flash, and in the first moment, and in the second moment, we are acquiring, we are registering, recording the reflection of the flash or the energy of the visible lights that we have emitted with our device on our sensors, on our detectors. And so, I mean, this is a very simple example that can make you simple to understand the difference between passive and active system. All right, let's go on. This is the very first figure that we are taking into consideration. This is related to the different classes of platforms the tar embarking sensor that are used for acquiring images or data over the ground. And so starting from the extreme parts of these figures, on the left part, you see that we have platforms that are embarking sensor, digital cameras in these cases, placed on board of drones or UAV unmanned aerial vehicles that are flying at a very low altitude, some dozen of meters. But in the extreme right, here you have also the possibility to acquire ground-based acquisition, what we call the proximal sensing. Then you have all the this belt here that is called airborne platforms, where you can take images from some hundreds of meters, for example by helicopters, few kilometers by this kind of aircraft that are usually used for photogrammetry, for aerial photogrammetry, but also here from some thousands of kilometers, from thousands of meters, for using, for example, this airborne SAR. SAR is an acronym we will learn at the end of the course, that stands for Synthetic Aperture Radar. This is a kind of sensitive active system. And then we have the spaceborne platforms. And the spaceborne platforms are divided into two different platforms. What is assimilating to the space shuttle, that means that our platforms that are launched from the Earth, but they can come back to the Earth landing. So I mean, there are missions that are taking off and landing on the Earth back, or satellite platforms that are not supposed to come back, but when their operational life is ended, they will stay in orbit in the middle of the space. What is very common in these platforms, apart from the distance, that is the concept of remote acquisition, and mean this distance you see can range from few meters to thousands of kilometers. What they have all these platforms in common is that one. Is that, I mean, you see here all the acquisition made by the sensors that are mounted on board of the platforms, it's happening using a perpendicular attitude. You see here, all the acquisition is not really through for all the different sensors, but at this stage of the course, we can consider that as a general statement. All the acquisition are, from the technical point of view, named as nadiral. So that means that the acquisition of these images, of this data, are perpendicular to the Earth's surface. So this is the geometry, defined as the acquisition geometry. The acquisition geometry, apart from the distance from the sensor and the target, that of course is ranging from the different platforms, has a very common thing. All the acquisition are perpendicular, in technical terms, natural. Okay, when we are talking about remote sensing, the data obtained through remote sensing techniques offer specific characteristics and sometimes have extremely significant, in some cases, unique advantages. Let's see which are the advantages. The first one is that definitely that the observer is placed in a very unusual condition. So the observer and the sensor is placed above from the Earth's surface, and this is a very big advantage because it's granting as I mentioned before, a synoptic views of the territory. And these things here, for example, make these things here very democratic from this point of view. Because, I mean, you can acquire whatever you want from a bomb. And for example, as is stated here, you can have images along the Mexico-United States border without any permission for anybody. So, I mean, the first advantage is having images acquired from above. The second advantage is the synoptic nature of the information that allows to cover large portion of the territory in a uniform way. So that means that considering the distance, being, for example, the satellite, the sensors mounted on board of satellite very far from the Earth's surface, they can image very large portion of the Earth's surface, and the possibility to acquire in a single shot very large portion of the Earth is definitely a very big advantage. Another advantage is the third one. It is the speed of access to information that allows, in certain conditions, to reach the user in almost real time. So, I mean, I mentioned the fact that, for example, if we are managing emergency, environmental emergencies, like, for example, a flood, I mean, you need your data as soon as possible. And this is the only techniques, I mean remote sensing, in which you can have the data in a very, very fast mode, at least in almost real time. Then the fourth advantage is the association of multiple data in the field of the electromagnetic spectrum, and the repetitiveness of the measurements over time are the basic concept of what we said about multi-temporal but also multi-spectral analysis. So the two basic advantages of remote sensing are the possibility, as we mentioned before, to allow and to grant multi-temporal analysis based on the fact that the images are acquired over the same area in different time span, but also the possibility to grant a multispectral analysis. So, as you will see later on, that these sensors are able to acquire also in region of the electromagnetic spectrum where our eyes is not sensitive at all. Then this is the last one is an advantage, but in some case could be a disadvantage, that right now there is still no sort of planetary spatial right you see here. So I mean, for us it's an advantage for civilian usage. For example, the satellites are acquiring whatever area on the Earth, without taking into consideration borders or political system or strategical problems. So that means, for example, that if I want to map all the nuclear power plants around the world, I can do that using satellite images. But at the same time, and maybe this is something that I'm interested in for, I don't know, for research or just for establishing the quantity of energy produced with nuclear powers, for example. But if at the same time I'm using this information in order to plan, for example, a terroristic attack, of course, that could cause many, many problems. So I mean, to see whatever you want is a big advantage in our case, but if we are interested in something that is illegal, that could be a big advantage that should be in some way restricted. But right now, it's not possible to do that anymore. Let's go away. So the most important feature of remote sensing is then the possibility to acquire data over the whole Earth surface. So this is the very most important characteristics of remote sensing. So it's very democratic, as I mentioned before. The satellites are orbiting around the Earth, and we will see in one of the next lectures the characteristic of these orbits, and taking advantage of the Earth rotation, after a while a single satellite could be imaged all the Earth surface, so we can acquire all the Earth surface. Here is written that although remote sensing is a relatively recent discipline, its potential can already be found in various sectors with important applications, example in its official inclusion in environmental analysis methodologies is becoming increasingly frequent. So you see that there are many references in environmental applications where remotely sensed data are used. But however, be aware that it should not be considered as an exhaustive solution to solve difficult or impossible cases. But rather as an enrichment and completion of other more tested scientific disciplines for the study of the environment. So I mean, we can remote sensing is very important, especially for me, of course. But I mean, could not be alone. Is not able alone to solve or to approach complex and different problems. But should be intended as an integration or more consolidated disciplines, for example. All right, so we are going to the finishing this first lecture, and for finishing we need to take into consideration this schema, this figure here, that is introducing the remote sensing components. This schema is very important because in this schema you can easily understand what are the topics that we need to investigate in order to fully understand the remote sensing process, as stated here in these figures. And you see we have here different components that are ranging from A, B, C, D, E, F, and G. And so the remote sensing system in which the electromagnetic radiation is the bond that holds the different components together. So here you don't see any electromagnetic radiation, but in every single point, starting from A to G, the electromagnetic radiation is exactly the bond of all these components. We need to examine all these different components. So we need to examine the point A, that is the source of energy, the point of B, that is the atmospheric interaction, the point C, that is the target interaction. Then we have to approach the energy detector, so the sensor point D, just understanding how this data acquired from the sensor D, that in this case is mounted on board of a satellite platforms, could be transmitted to the ground to be used by the users, or in a direct way, or triangulating by satellites. I'm sorry, and then to point F and G, in which in a point F we are interpreting and analyzing the data, and then in point G we are producing data. So this is the figure, and we will see point by point in the next five slides all the different points. So first one, the energy source. You see in most part of the source we will take into account especially passive system. So if they are considering that the sensor that are mounted on modern satellites and the sensor we are going to use during the course are passive, we need an external source of electromagnetic radiation. So this external source, of course, is the sun, and so we need to understand how much energy and what kind of energy the sun is emitting. And this is the very important and first things. In the second, when the sun has emitted energy, this energy that is going through the Earth's surface is passing through the atmosphere. So, passing from the atmosphere, we need to take into consideration the interaction between the electromagnetic energy that is emitted by the sun and the atmosphere. And so, in the atmosphere, there are happening many different phenomena that are very important for remote sensing. Then, when the energy emitted from the sun and bypassed by the atmosphere is striking over the Earth's surface, we need to take into consideration the broader topics related to the interaction between the electromagnetic energy coming from the sun and the Earth's surface. And so, to check how the surfaces are, as mentioned before, are reflecting, emitting, or transmitting energy that is coming from the sun. Then the energy, in the way back to the platform, to the satellite platforms, where the sensor are mounted, are going back, so having another interaction with the atmosphere, but in the point D, we need to fully understand how detectors and then sensors are working, because otherwise we cannot understand how these data and the images are formed. Then, having mentioned the facts that this data should be transmitted definitely on the ground in order to be used by users, by the different users, we have two different points that are the data processing and interpretation. So, I mean, we need to describe and to get used, especially during the labs, of all the data processing tools and algorithms that allows us to process the different data. And in the end, we need, of course, to extract, as we mentioned before, information from this data. So, closing this first lecture, we need to pay attention in the last two slides to remote sensing application. So, in order to meet the needs of the end users, there are remote sensing systems that offers a wide range of different operating characteristics, both in terms of acquisition temporal frequency and spatial and spectral resolution. So, I mean, the different sensors by themselves or by the means of the different orbits of the satellite on which they are mounted, they can grant different characteristics. And these different characteristics in terms of image acquisition are granting the possibility to approach different applications. Which are these different applications? I mean, this is not, of course, an exhaustive list, but just a tentative list and just an examples. And for example, the first one is environmental control and monitoring, for example, the human expansion, the soil degradation, etc., etc. All the topics related to climate change, for example, ozone depletion, deforestation, global warming, desertification, etc. Very important application related to agriculture, related, for example, to the phenological state of the vegetation, crop forecast, soil erosion, and so on and so. Mining and oil exploration, where is took into consideration the air structure and, the, for example, the geomorphology. All the application related to renewable resources, like wetlands, soils, forests, oceans, inland waters, and hydrogeology in general, all what is attaining to meteorology, that is a very wide application field of remote sensing in terms of atmosphere dynamics and weather forecast, all the production of thematic maps for land use, for civil engineering and for landscape units, for example. But don't forget that the remote sensing had in the 70s the more important impulse, and till now this is the most important application, is related to military application, in particular military reconnaissance, the embedding all the strategic policy and tactical control. I mean, military application in remote sensing are a very broad range of application, and military are using their own satellites that, of course, that are not usable by civilians, by civil applications. So civilians can use only civilian satellites, while military are using both their own satellites and both the civilians' ones. But never forget that also military applications are very important. But in this course, of course, we are not involved in this kind of application at all. All right, so this is the end of the first lecture. Thank you for your attention, and we will meet for the second lecture. Thanks a lot.